Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman, and it is another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with Raj Ganapathy, and we're talking about availability zones. One of the great things about the cloud is the ability to be available at all times, and you're making it easier.
Yeah. Thanks, Scott, for having me here. So we announced the public preview of availability zones at Ignite this year. With that, we are extending the portfolio of resiliency offerings that Azure provides. Customers can today build highly available applications using availability sets and virtual machine scale sets.
Right.
And they can also protect their applications and data from disasters through taking advantage of geo-redundant storage, our GRS offering, and Azure Site Recovery by replicating their data and stateful VMs across different regions. Availability zones offers yet another capability for customers to build highly available applications within a region. The benefit that availability zones offers is that it protects customers' applications and data within a region from data center level failures.
Ah, okay, so the underlying database, if there is a problem, this protects from that issue?
So yes, it does. And what we basically are doing is that availability zones are fault isolated locations within an Azure region. And each availability zones consists of one or more data centers, right? So with each of them having independent power, network, and cooling. Let's say, for example, one of the zones goes down because of a flood taking down one part of the city,
right?
If the customers have deployed their applications by replicating across three zones within the region, their applications will not see or experience any downtime, and their business continuity is not going to get impacted.
Interesting.
Within a region.
When I think, and I think when other people think naively of Azure from the user's perspective, I see a drop-down box and I hit West US or North Central, and I can imagine that there's a football field-sized thing full of computers. But in fact, West US isn't one box.
Yeah, with availability zones, what's going to happen is you could think of three different football field size data centers, wherein customers deploying their applications are distributed. However, one of the key value propositions that we are offering with the availability zones is it's not only providing high availability, it also enables low latency replication for customers.
Oh, wow. And it's low latency because it's
within the same region. Right, within the same region.
Interesting region, okay. Because there's thinking about what rack I'm on and having a separate rack in case these racks go down. There's being in separate zones within a data center because power. And now there's being within separate data centers within a zone.
Within a region.
That gives a lot of power within a region. Pardon me for my misuse. So zones and regions.
Yes, that's correct. Okay. So if you currently think about it, right, you have geography wherein we have two regions. Let's take, for example, North Europe and West Europe.
Okay.
Right? They are part of the Europe region for us.
Ah.
So these two are in two different cities in Europe.
Right.
So we are adding availability zones within West Europe, wherein you're going to have three different availability zones in West Europe. So the hierarchy is geography, region, availability zones. And within the availability zones, which is not explicitly exposed for the customers, is the data center and the racks and the nodes, et cetera.
And yeah, hopefully you're exposing that and you're going to show me in a way that's going to be very easy.
Absolutely.
Where as the programmer, I don't think about it.
Yep.
And the DevOps people don't have to think too hard.
So that's a good time for us to jump into the first demo.
Yes, sir.
So where I'm going to now go and create a simple VM. I'm going to place it in a zone. So I'm going to pick a Ubuntu server as the OS option for me. So what we have tried to make sure with availability zones is that we have made sure that the workflow that the customers have to follow, whether be it in portal or PowerShell or command line interface, all of them are consistent. It's just that an additional parameter called availability zones that need to be chosen by the customer so that they can pin their particular virtual machine in that particular zone.
I assume it's an optional parameter because it didn't exist before.
Yeah, that's right.
All right.
So I'm going to just call this easy demo VM. And so this is exactly the same set of steps that you follow in creating a VM. So I'm going to use a resource group that I already had created for this particular demo. And I'm going to choose the location as West Europe.
Right.
So the thing that I want to point out at this point of time is we are in public preview and we are available in two regions at this point of time, which are West Europe and East US 2. And we are aggressively adding more regions.
Okay.
And that update is available for customers in the AZ overview page.
All right. So I've picked West Europe before. I'm familiar with that.
Yeah.
So that doesn't feel too different or different than what I've done before.
Exactly.
All right.
So after that, I'm going to pick a SKU, let's say DS3B2.
Okay.
And at this point of time, what the portal is going to show up is it's going to ask me if I want to place this particular VM in a particular zone. So what happens is if the customer chooses the region in which we are offering availability zones and the SKU that is supporting availability zones, this option will get automatically enabled.
Okay.
And the customer can choose that, you know, I want to place this VM in a particular zone.
And this is a logical number that I don't have to think about. I'm not trying to pick a city.
Yeah.
Just like keeping things separate from the rack and giving availability
separate data centers.
Separate data centers.
Yeah.
No, but I'm familiar in the past with doing availability sets.
Yes.
Just giving by giving them the same name,
yep.
it had them separate.
Exactly.
And here, by giving them different numbers,
yes.
it makes them separate.
Absolutely. So you could think of that hierarchy of fault tolerance.
Mm-hmm.
Availability sets protects from hardware level failures and software level update failures.
Right.
Availability zones protects from data center level failures and software update level failures.
Fantastic. All right. So I just pick my logical number there.
Yeah.
And then if I made another VM with a different number, I can rest assured it's separate.
It is separate. So I'm going to leave rest of the parameters as is, and then I'm just going to just say OK. And then once the final validation is complete, I'm going to go and say purchase. Okay.
All right, and then that deployment is being submitted.
The process. So this is a very basic scenario where mm-hmm. we are talking about creating a single VM, right?
Right.
If you think about an enterprise-grade application and protecting that application from disaster events and making sure they are highly available, you would want to distribute your VMs and the applications that are running on top of it across multiple zones.
Right, and I would assume that I would do this with some coding or a template or PowerShell.
Yeah, so we are making it all of them simple through cross-zone virtual machine scale sets.
Ooh.
So you've heard of the scale sets wherein you can have homogeneous set of VMs
right.
that are created
right.
within a region.
Mm-hmm.
With cross-zone virtual machine scale sets, what we are offering is when you pick a region and specify the zones in which you want to have the virtual machines that are there within the scale sets,
right.
it'll automatically distribute across the zones.
Oh.
So I'm going to quickly go and show
That's
you.
That's convenient.
I've created a cross-zone virtual machine scale set, and this is the
right.
Resource group, and this is the scale set. So
okay.
I'm going to quickly click on it.
How many VMs are in there?
So I've just for sample purposes, demo purposes, created three VMs,
right.
and I've chosen three zones. So what it has done is, in West Europe, it has placed one VM each in each of the three zones. So thereby, the application that is going to run on top mm-hmm. of this virtual machine scale set is automatically going to get the benefit of high availability and protection from data center level.
So then this high availability scale set's doing the right thing automatically. If I said six, it would spread them out.
If
I said five, it might be 1, 2, 3, 1, 2.
Exactly, exactly. And we have the flexibility for the customers to customize it. If they want to put it across two zones, they can do it. If they want to put it across three zones, they can do it.
Mm-hmm.
They can choose to put it across all of them in one zone.
Mm-hmm.
But they are not going to get the benefit of high availability capability from availability zones offers
right.
if you're going to put everything in.
If I already have an existing scale set, can I convert it to a high availability?
At this point of time, we are not supporting the migration, but mm-hmm. that's something that will be coming up in future.
But if I have an ARM template already, I could make a simple one-line change.
Absolutely.
And then I could tear them down, bring them back up again, and it'll happen automatically.
Exactly.
Just by the fact that it's a high availability scale set.
Yes, that's correct.
That's pretty slick. Right.
So what I've done in addition to creating the virtual machines here is that, as you can see, this is the load balancer that is sitting in front of the three virtual machines.
Right.
And I have deployed Apache on it, and I've created a dummy web page.
Okay.
And as you can see, the public IP address, I'm going
right.
to go to the
and
public
IP. And I see you've
IP.
Got load balancing rules, so
yes.
someone is watching port 80 to make sure that it's up and
yes,
working.
Yes, absolutely. And you can see the DNS name here.
All right.
So this is the page which is running, and this particular page is getting served from the VM that is running on zone 2.
And how does it get that zone? From an environment variable?
Yes. So mm-hmm. the metadata service, instant metadata,
the metadata
service
yes.
will provide it. So I've just updated this, for example, right?
Excellent.
So now, what is a real life scenario that availability zones protects from? Is a zone down failure,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So you can see that this page is getting served from zone 2.
Yeah.
And also, I have a simple script, which I'm going to quickly run. What it does is it basically parses the result with disable keep alive so that there is no affinity between my machine and the load balancer.
Right.
So you can see that the response is coming from all three zones and all three VMs.
Yeah, okay? It's just cycling. It's round robin.
Round robin. So because it is disable keep alive.
Indeed.
Right. So what I'm going to do now is, so this is coming from zone two,
right.
And we know we'll go to the scale set here.
Okay.
And I'm going to go and kill the VM that
is
running.
So you're simulating a zone down
scenario by just killing it, right? So I'm going to deallocate this particular VM.
All right.
Okay. So the underscore one, I've started from zero, so that one is running on zone two of West Europe region.
And you kept your ping there running
ping that
in
is
the
running,
background.
Right.
You're
so
tossing two.
So you are still getting
three, one, two, three, two is still there.
Yeah, still there.
Still being shut down. And it's been, so when you deallocate there, it's somewhat graceful.
It is graceful, yeah. So
you didn't pull the plug.
I didn't pull the plug. So
yeah.
Assume that it happens. You pull the plug, it'll automatically start reflecting.
Right. Regardless whether it be graceful or not graceful, eventually
the scenario is the same.
Okay, and then the
so as you can see,
there it is.
Is coming
and now it's done. One and three.
And I'll go here and then refresh this.
And then two becomes one. That's fantastic. And a good reminder, by the way, we did a video on the metadata service where you're getting that information.
Yep.
So it sounds like you've enlisted into that service, and now that's another piece of metadata that people can receive within their virtual machines.
Yep. And also in the portal, the information. So we can just quickly go back to the VM that we were trying to create.
Mm-hmm.
As you can see, the VM is created
yep.
and the associated resources. So
right.
I'm going to click on the VM. And you'll see the new property.
And there's the new property.
Availability zone.
All right.
And similarly, we have the managed disk, which is associated with that particular VM.
Which is also a hope in the zone.
It is in the same
in
zone.
In the same zone.
And the third property, which completes the triumvirate of compute, storage, and networking.
Mm.
Is the IP address.
Is there as well. And I assume that it would be hard if I were to accidentally have a VM in one zone and the storage in another, and
yes.
if I did, there would be problems.
The platform will not allow to associate the
Good.
Two of them because at that point of time, it will violate the promise of zone isolation.
Zone isolation. Fantastic. So this is in public preview now,
yes.
and you're starting in West Europe and?
East US 2, and currently we are supporting virtual machines, scale sets, load balancers, and public IP. And we are working through adding higher-level PaaS and SaaS services,
mm-hmm.
and we are aggressively working towards expanding it to more regions across US, Europe, and Asia.
Very cool. Fantastic. And a very compelling demo. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. I am learning all about availability zones now in preview here on Azure Friday.